Thanks be to God, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, that by his great mercy we are born anew into lives filled with hope. And so we gather today, glad for the opportunity to be together. Let me remind you of the attendance registers on the inside aisle end of the pew. If you'll pass those along and back, we'll know that you were here, and that'll be helpful to us. Encourage those who are visiting to give us information about how we can follow up on getting to know you better. Give us your cell phone or your email or your home address, whatever you feel like, and we would look forward to doing that. As always, several announcements. Following this service of worship, we will be having soup and sandwich to fill you up, and then a dessert auction. This is to raise some funds to support our church's outreach to Habitat for Humanity, and it's always a tremendous amount of fun. That will be in the fellowship hall. Hope that you can be a part of that. It's a chance to silent bid also on one of Herb Simmons' decorative but also functional birdhouses. So if you've always wanted one of those whimsical birdhouses, here's an opportunity. And also an auction of Georgiana Capito's pet portraits. I can speak to those because Ann and I had a portrait done of our grand dog, Elizabeth's schnauzer, and for Christmas, and it was just delightful. So if that's something you'd be interested in, that's also an opportunity this afternoon immediately following this service of worship. Food, glorious food. At 9 o'clock this morning, we had a fellowship gathering up on the top floor, the top landing, and had some delicious cheese and bacon and an egg mini bagels. What a great deal. And at 9 o'clock, we'll continue to do that on the top landing. I encourage you to be a part of that fellowship at 9 in the morning. Some people get up early and want to come to church and already be active, and so that's an opportunity at 9. We will continue, though, to have our 11:30 fellowship immediately following this service of worship. And on pleasant days, especially as we get into the fall, we're going to try to have those fellowship times on the sidewalk as we did last week. This week, of course, we will not be having that particular fellowship because we'll be having the dessert auction in our fellowship hall. Next Sunday is World Communion Sunday. That is a distinctly Presbyterian program, but we do think about churches all over the globe celebrating communion together, and as a way of sort of reaching out to one another and joining hands as Christians, the congregation of the Cecilia Memorial Presbyterian Church on College Street will be joining us for worship next Sunday. October 18th is coming up. That's also a Sunday, and that afternoon we'll be having our annual blessing of the pets, and so you may be wanting to tell your goldfish that you'll be carrying them to church on that day, October 18th. Normally it's just dogs, but we do welcome other pets, and we've encouraged people even to bring exotic pets if they have the nerve, so we're looking forward to that. And our youth will be providing, if it's a warm day, it'll be an ice cream social. If it's a cold day, the youth will be providing hot chocolate for us on that day. And finally, something else to mark your calendar, October 30th to November 1st, an opportunity. Ann Laird Jones, who directs the art program at Montreat Conference Center, will be with us again. Ann will be leading us in a worship and art festival together, and ultimately we will together create some banners for the Advent season. If you don't feel like an artistic person, you still can participate in this. Trust me, Ann is a wonderful teacher and an encourager, and so mark your calendar for the end of this month as we prepare for Advent together. Lots of good things going on, and we do celebrate the ministry that we share and enjoy indeed together. Let us worship God. Thank you.
God is calling us to worship. Jesus has said, I am the way. Jesus said, I am the truth. Jesus said, I am the life for you.
When we say we have no sin, we are self-deceived, and there's no truth in us. But when we confess our sin, our Lord is gracious and merciful and willing to forgive. Together, let us pray together the prayer as it's printed in our order of service. Loving God, in you we find the hope of belonging, the offer of welcome, the discovery of peace. Further, it is our joy to share what we have found broadly with many others we know, and some we do not yet know. So we pray, protect us from ourselves when we neglect to invite people along or forget to include them. Make us aware of the selfish things we think and do, and help us to do better. Forgive us and guide us to amend our lives, that we may cover others with the same love that covers us. In the name of Christ. Amen.
We may grow weary, we may grow tired and indifferent, but the Holy Spirit breathes into the very depths of our being, restoring us to lives that reflect the goodness of God. So let's sing and give thanks to God. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thank you.
let us greet one another as a sign of God's peace. And the peace of Christ be with you. And let us share that peace.
And now let us bow our heads as we ask God's Spirit to speak to us in the words we read and hear this day. Let us all pray. Lord, our whole lives are a business of making ready to hear from you. And so quiet our minds and give us open ears and spirits that we might hear what you would say to us in your word. Bless us in the reading and hearing of your word this day. And these things we pray in Christ our Lord. Amen. Our psaltery reading is from the 124th Psalm, a psalm which talks about going to worship, but going to worship with a particular purpose, and that is to feel the comfort and relief and even the rescue that God offers. It is a responsive reading. If the Lord had not been on our side, now may Israel say, then they would have swallowed us alive. Then the waters would have overwhelmed us and the torrent gone over us. But praised be the Lord. We have escaped like a bird from the snare of a fowler. Our help is in the name of the Lord. Amen. And let me ask the children who are present if you'll join me on the steps for a moment. Beautiful children, handsome youngins. Okay, well, I've got a sign here, which we'll be seeing more of. What do you see on that sign? The Giving Tree, yeah, all right. And there's a wonderful book called The Giving Tree. Have you ever heard of that book? I happen to have it right here, The Giving Tree. Do you know how it goes? What? Just give me sort of a quick story here. We won't read it. We'll just hear about it. Nate?
The Giving Tree gives the boy everything that it can.
Yeah? Except a place to rest. That's amazing that you would be able to pull all that together. I had to reread it myself in order to be reminded of how the story goes. But that's exactly right, and that's got really all the details in it. Yes? Yeah, it's just a tree stump. He makes it into a boat. Very good. That's right. You all are so smart. Like I said, I had to reread it to get all these details, but you're right. And the tree says something every time it gives its leaves to the boy, or gives its sticks to make a house, or gives the lumber to make the boat, or even when it's just a stump and there's nothing there except for the old man to rest himself. The tree says something every time it gives something to the boy. Do you know what? Do you remember that? That's asking a lot, I realize. It says, and the tree was happy. The tree was happy to give all of that stuff. You'd think the tree might get a little frustrated when it has to get cut down in order to make a boat and stuff like that. I mean, that's a pretty serious giving there, giving sacrifice. But the tree does that all along. And every time it does give something, the tree says, or the book says, the tree was happy. Now, let's make a little jump from the story of the giving tree to our own lives. When you give something to someone, does it make you happy? Good. Well, you probably figured that was the right answer. Can you give me an example of that? Can you think of a time when you gave something to someone and it made you happy? That's also asking a lot. Nate? Donate to the food pantry. Makes you feel good. Yeah, good. Thank you. Very good. Sometimes it's something just as simple as helping a new kid in school or something. Yes? Giving your time. Good. Very good. Sometimes you can just smile at somebody and make them feel better about themselves, and that's that makes you feel good too. You ever had that experience? Occasionally. All right. I can tell from your faces that you know what I'm, at least know what I'm talking about. Well, one of the things that we're going to do in our church is make this season of the year, when we think about being generous to the church and we think about being generous to others, we're going to use this as our theme, the giving tree. And really, in the story, the tree is the one who does the giving. And so we're thinking about being trees ourselves and reaching out the way a church or a tree reaches out to others. We're thinking about giving what we have. The tree had apples, the tree had leaves, the tree had wood for the young man's house. We give also to others in our community and try to be giving always. And so as we think about our church, we're going to think about the church as a giving tree and how we ourselves can be made to feel good by giving in and through the church. Every time the tree gave something, it said, and the tree was happy. And I think maybe at the end it even says, and the tree was very happy. But anyway, we'll be very happy when we're able to give to one another and to our community through the church. Let's have a prayer. Lord, so many things happen in our lives. We get so busy, we almost forget to be kind to others. And so help us to take a deep breath, as it were, so that we might indeed have the time and the attention to give to the needs around us. Thank you for these children. Thank you for their amazing awareness of the world around them. Thank you for their goodness. And we pray through them, encourage the rest of us to share fully. And these things we pray in Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you so much. turn now to our gospel reading for the day from Mark and the 9th chapter. Jesus has been teaching his disciples about what it means to take up their cross and to follow him. The disciples get it a little bit confused, and so Jesus has to make an object lesson out of a particular incident where someone is casting demons out but not following the disciples. Let us stand together for the reading of the gospel. The disciple John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon after to speak evil of us. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose his reward." And this is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. Well, let us ask, who is Jesus for the person who's just a little bit different? And how very important it is that that person who's maybe a little bit different would be accepted here in the church where they belong, and maybe accepted here as they are accepted nowhere else in all the world. And who is Jesus for the couple who doesn't come to church anymore? Maybe they've got some quarrel. Or for the person who had to retire from activities because of bad health. Or the person who just seems chronically and permanently mad about everything. Those relationships, they aren't very easy. Who is Jesus for those people? What makes us the church? We're not all alike in this congregation. I think that's one of the blessings we enjoy, frankly. We've got more flavors than an ice cream parlor. Some of us are young, some of us are old, some are wealthy, some struggle in life. We have people with deep roots in Bowling Green going back multiple generations, and we've got some people who are just here until they can get their degree and get out. We're all different. We have a terrific young woman. She really is terrific in our youth group, who showed up about a month ago with ice blue hair. And she belongs, believe me, she does. And we have a lot of people who love our new purple hymnal. But some who haven't really liked the hymnal back well since, never mind. Okay, so you'll say, we get it. People are different. Yeah, okay. In this steady and stable church, we have all these different people. And the world is wide, and out there in the wide world, there are even more different people and even more differences. And who is Jesus for us? Who is Jesus for all of us? Who is Jesus? The disciples have been having kind of a bad day in the text from Mark. Jesus has said for the second time that his way is the way of self-sacrifice, of servanthood, even death for the sake of love. But the disciples have so inappropriately, so incongruously decided to argue about who among them is the greatest. How peculiar. We don't know if anybody in first century Palestine ever said, hey, it's not all about you. But if they didn't say that, this would have been a good time to do so. Instead, Jesus takes and puts a child among them. And he talks about vulnerability and weakness and welcoming whoever welcomes one such child welcomes me, he says, and the one who sent me. It's not too hard to welcome a child, of course, but welcoming Jesus and some of his messy ideas about giving ourselves up for each other, taking up our crosses and following him, that's not so welcome. And children, after all, do grow up. They grow up into adults with opinions and bad habits and complicated lives and a bent for complaining. Who will be Jesus for them? I heard a great story, and unfortunately it's a true story. I heard it Wednesday at our Ukirk worship service here. Turns out, and we read about this in our local newspaper, some young people from the Holy Spirit Catholic Church here in Bowling Green planned a trip to see Pope Francis in Philadelphia. They chartered a bus and everything. But calling for hotel rooms, they found that all the hotel rooms in Philadelphia and all around were already booked. And they decided, well, we'll call other Catholic churches. Maybe we can at least sleep on their floors. So someone from Holy Spirit called churches in the Philadelphia area. No, they're all filled already with pilgrims coming to see the Pope. There's no floor space left. And so somebody from Holy Spirit got really creative and called a synagogue. Synagogue Beth El Nertamid in Broomall, Pennsylvania. And the synagogue, they had floor space. And they were so excited to be able to help participate in this grand celebration in their community that they immediately offered to also make dinner for the group from Holy Spirit, those Christians from the Holy Spirit Church. And that wasn't the end of it. There was a benefactor in that congregation, Synagogue Bethel, and the benefactor was so taken with the opportunity that he went out and bought 40 tickets to some sort of special audience with the Pope. So, what this means is that the Holy Spirit contingent, who almost didn't have a place to sleep on their trip to see the Pope, they're now in the fourth row back, center stage, together. A synagogue in suburban Philadelphia has helped Christians from Bowling Green get closer to the Vicar of Christ. Who is Jesus in this story? Ironic, isn't it? Well, back to the text from Mark. The disciples were having a bad day. They see this man casting out demons, which we know was a form of healing in that day, casting out demons and doing it in Jesus' name. But this guy is not exactly a Christian, or maybe he is, but he's not their kind of Christian. And the disciples say a kind of foolish thing. They say, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he wasn't following us." Not following us. Well, of course, we do the same thing. And often we probably aren't even aware we're doing it. We don't do it on purpose. We do, though, seem to be instinctively hardwired to kind of divide the world up between us and them. We do it to protect ourselves, I'm sure. Even in the church, we do it. But Jesus, of course, teaches another way. Jesus says, you know, it really isn't all about protecting ourselves. No, not at all. It's about giving ourselves away. It's about supporting each other along the way, because it is a difficult way. Take up your cross. It's about being the church rooted in the way of Jesus Christ. And I suppose it's never too late to start following. In the text this morning, Jesus says that anyone who uses the name of Jesus for good can't be all bad. And he says, whoever is not against us should be considered one of us. Now, it's a little bit risky accepting people this way, trusting each other. It's a little risky and kind of difficult, but it is so healthy and so right. It is, I think, the very way forward in this wide world of differences. It's the way we ought to be the church. Jesus says that anybody, and the Pew Bibles say, whoever gives out even a cup of cold water, something so simple as that, a cup of cold water, something intended to break down the us and them barriers, whoever does something like that will be blessed, will not lose their reward, it says. Jesus invites us to live for one another. Now, I'll admit, it's not immediately easy, but it's probably not as hard as we think it is. The kid in the youth group with the permanent sneer, the university student trying out some funny theological ideas, but trying to get it right in his own mind and heart. The person that you might ordinarily argue with, why not give them the day off from arguing? The system that makes you angry, the structure that you can't see around, the church that once in a while disappoints you. If you can just offer someone a cup of cold water, how about also taking a deep breath for yourself? How about that importance of extending grace and offering forgiveness and offering to make a new start with people or with systems or even with the church? None of this is easy, we're admitting that, but it seems to be clearly a part of what Christ has called us to do. He calls us to put ourselves away, maybe just a little, put ourselves away for the sake of those around us. Who is Jesus to them? Well, it could be you. John Calvin, the 16th century theologian of our Reformed faith tradition, had an interesting notion. He had notion of the visible church and the invisible church. The visible church, of course, is the church that's obvious. It's the people who walk the walk and talk the talk and come to church and know all the hymns, and these are people for whom heaven will be a welcome place because they've been practicing for it all of their lives. But the invisible church, Calvin says, we don't really know who's in or who's out, so we should endeavor to treat all people as if they're in. There's a poem, and some of you English professors out there might call it an epigram, not a poem. It's entitled Outwitted by Edwin Markham. He drew a circle that shut me out, heretic, rebel, a thing to flout. But love and I had the wit to win. We drew a circle and took him in. Do you buy that kind of lifestyle? The lifestyle that accepts, the lifestyle that sees that more is being done in the name of Christ than we imagine, and that who's in and who's out can be a little fuzzy, that even the little things, such as a cup of cold water, matter a lot. Do you accept that living in this way is part of living for Jesus? Do you? Well, there's motivation all around. Indeed, look all around you. These people really need Jesus. And thanks be to God this day. Let us all pray. Lord, we find it remarkable that the faith is hard because it does push against the grain a little bit, and yet the faith is easy because it leads us to do and be everything that you created us to do and be. And so, bless us to overcome the obstacles and enter more fully into the life that you have called us to do. And these things we pray in Christ our Lord. Amen. Our affirmation of faith this week is printed in our order of service. We are called as a church to serve in the world. Together, we are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created us and is always creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works with us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live faithfully with one another, to keep to what is right, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life and death, and in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Amen. And please be seated.
Let us pray. We thank you for this day, gracious God, for another opportunity to worship here together in this sanctuary, for one more chance to experience your presence here with us. We thank you for your love for us, a love that reaches out to accept us wherever we are and whoever we are. And we thank you for our Catholic friends who have welcomed their leader to our country this week. And we pray that his message of peace and faith and basic human rights will be shared by all of us. We ask you to remind us how fragile the ties that give us life here on this earth are. Help us to be more understanding of our weakness and more trusting of your strength, to be more aware of our sins and more dependent on the forgiveness you offer to us so freely. We bring before you now all that troubles us, our failures, our errors and bitterness. We pray that you would raise us up and renew our hearts. And we lift up before you those of us who suffer from illness, those who struggle with despair or loneliness, and pray that you would put your healing touch upon them. Especially today, we remember the Reber family and extend to them our love and concern. Lord, help us to remember that although our burdens are heavy and many, we don't carry them alone. Help us to remember that even though we are imperfect, you are perfect. And teach us to rely on your healing hand and your grace to bring peace to the world, to our homes and our hearts. Please strengthen us in our work and worship, and fill our hearts with your love, and give us great confidence that on that great getting up morning, we shall rise, hallelujah, we shall rise. And let us pray as we've been taught to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We are beginning, moving into our stewardship season, the season in which we think about the meaning of stewardship and being generous. And to help us with some of those thoughts, Jody Johnson is here today. Jody, thank you.
I might have to adjust this. Can you hear me all right? Because last time I was in this place, and afterward, Melissa said to me, my loving daughter-in-law, Mamie, I didn't hear a word you said. You forgot to adjust the microphone. So here we are. Sweet. Oh, I have to put these glasses on, which I had to borrow because they weren't in my purse when I got here. Sweet Lady Liza Arndt asked me to speak today. I don't think she knows that it makes Matthew very nervous when he sees my name on the roster. Remember now, Matthew, most of the time, anticipation is much worse than the deed, okay? Those of you who have done this know the challenge to first get the attention of the congregation, then motivate, encourage, remind. Liza laid it on me, though. She said, now remember, Jody, you only have 4 or 5 minutes at the most. Searching for inspiration to do just the right thing, I've been watching Pope Francis this week. He accomplishes a lot. He encourages and reminds and gets people's attention. And that's because I think he smiles a lot. So I'm going to smile a lot. I want you to smile a lot, too, as I try to say something meaningful. Without any prodding at all, you and I can think of a million reasons we want to support this church, and we should. Because most of our truly life-changing and life-affirming events take place here. I started to list those, but when I got through, I had a 20-minute speech, so I couldn't do that. I could go on and on, but so many of you have experienced the same thing that I have. You have just been supported and loved and affirmed by this church ever since you came here. And I have too. Well, please listen to this poem that I think sort of says it all, because our church is truly more than brick and stone. Our church is more than brick and stone. Its walls hold memories dear and sad. Its hymns play back the days of youth when snug between our moms and dads, we learned to sing and pray. Our church is more than spire or cross. Its lessons mold our thoughts and deeds. Its teachers make us memorize those verses that our spirits need to call upon along life's way. Our church has spirit high with merriment from wedding vows and newborn babes, and spirit sad when someone leaves the fold or strays. Most of all, our church is love. Its people nurture, tend, and teach. We teach each other, then reach out to help those folks whose needs are greater still. To love a church is more than just a church. It's loving, too, the God who sent his son to die upon that cross for me and you. Thank you.
Now let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice unto God. Let us come before God with our tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, out of your grace we find our lives fulfilled, and we give thanks for that. As we give thanks, we return now in worship and make these our thank offerings. Receive them, we pray. Bless them as they go on their way. Use them to fulfill your purposes in the world and through the church. And these things we pray in Christ our Lord. Amen. Maybe you missed out on those delicious egg and sausage bagels at 9 o'clock, but there's another chance, and that is the dessert auction, soup and sandwich lunch and dessert auction immediately following this service of worship in the fellowship hall. Encourage you to be there and to be a part of that. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you, each one, and abide with you forever. Amen.